You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Everyone, and welcome to Bio 190. I am Kira Mathis, your teacher. Hopefully everyone knows that by now. And if you're joining us just because you're watching on TV, thanks for hanging out with us this afternoon. So I've got Cassandra here with me today. So she is one of my coworkers at the aquarium, and she'll be introducing herself in just a few moments. But before that, I do want to go over all the nitty-gritty stuff that we do in the beginning of the class. So last week was a pre-recorded session, but I want to touch base on our question of the day from 2 weeks ago. So the question of the day was, how many penguins can a polar bear eat in an hour? It was a trick question. Most of you guys got it perfectly, which is that it was meant to be a little funny, but obviously you had to look into it and go, wait a minute for a second. So great. However, some of you actually had answers, and I don't mean the, well, if a polar bear eats this many kilograms a day and a penguin is it. Those were funny. I laughed at those too. But some of you actually put in a number. You had a very specific number, and I'm guessing that you got that from a very basic Google search. However, this is a great time to bring up a thing called reputable sources. With your research paper that is coming up, that's going to be due in November, when you're looking at sources and you're citing stuff, you want to make sure it is a reputable source. I have posted a link. There is one on the Blackboard for reputable sources. I suggest you take a look and do some research on the sites that you're looking at to make sure that they are reputable. So you don't want just any website that someone created that's putting information. They could make everything up, and just because it's a website doesn't mean it's true. It's not like people go through there and fact check. Wikipedia is a perfect example of that. It's hit or miss, so sometimes there's not a lot of great information on there. Sometimes it is correct. Wikipedia is a great starting point, but you want to go find the actual sources that back Wikipedia up, and it does have links, and you want to reference those sources, not Wikipedia. So just wanted to bring that up today as well. The midterm opens today. So that is, I believe it's 30 points. I will wait, my syllabus hopefully will get brought to me because I left it in the other room. So I can double check, I think it's 30 points. But your midterm opens today. Normally we give you guys a week to do the quizzes, but for the midterm, I'm actually gonna give you about a week and a half. So when class ends today, you have your normal weekly quiz, you have your normal weekly discussion board, you have your normal weekly participation points. In addition to that, the midterm will also open. Everything else closes as normal right before class next Tuesday, but I will give you until next Friday to do the midterm specifically. So you have until next Friday at 3 p.m. to get the midterm completed. So a little bit longer than a week for that. It is on everything that we've talked about up until now, including your readings. So make sure you study. It's 1 hour. It's not like the quiz. You can't take it twice. You only get to take it once. It's timed. So make sure that you study. You won't have time to look up those answers on the fly. I think that's it. If I think of anything else, I will mention it again. Also, don't forget, if you need to email me, please email me at bio190@lbaop.org. The email that you saw right before that, that's for talking to the class today. So you can email in your questions to the other email. If you need to get in touch with me after class, please email me at this email that you see below. I do not get emails via Blackboard. This is the one to get a hold of me. So, all right, with that, I think we're all good. Don't forget to get your participation points today. We've got a great class getting ready to get started. So with that, Cassandra, thank you again for being here today. So why don't you introduce yourself to the class, tell us a little bit about you and how you got here and all that fun stuff.
All right, well, my name's Cassandra, and I started off at New York University. I got my undergrad out there, and then I went ahead and did my master's at Oregon State University. I volunteered with the aquarium for quite some time, and then joined the aquarium staff in the education department. I've worked in a number of the departments at the aquarium, including marketing and special events, but my favorite's probably education.
I was just gonna say, you know, something I didn't mention is that Cassandra has been involved in this class for the last 2 years, helping me grade some of your papers, so. Yeah, be nice to Cassandra today. All right, cool. So today's discussion is on fish. So we're going to be looking at fish. Quite literally, we have some mackerel here that we're going to literally just be dissecting through the entire class with some great photos and videos. We can pull that out. So before we get started and we start really looking at our fish here, let's talk about how fish kind of fit into the animal kingdom. So Cassandra, walk me through that.
All right, so fish, they're part of the animal kingdom, Kingdom Animalia, the phylum Chordata.
So they have a chordate, like a backbone, right, basically?
Backbones. And subphylum Vertebrata, so they have vertebrae. And there are three main classes of fish. We have the lampreys, which are the agnatha, the chondrichthyes, which are the sharks and rays and other cartilaginous fish generally. And then we have these guys, the osteichthyes, the bony fish.
Right. That way he's not upside down. There we go. Cool. Okay.
All right, and there's about 18,000 species in osteichthyes.
So I think the big thing to point out with this especially is that as we're talking about the different types of fish, next week we're going to be talking about sharks and rays, the chondrichthyes. But these guys are specifically bony fish, right? And that's where their class name comes from, essentially. So we're going to be looking at the bones of it and all that stuff. But there's a lot to learn from the external anatomy of fish as well. And that's what we're going to dive into a little bit first. So maybe you can walk me through, Cassandra, what makes a fish a little bit, and what are the features that we can see here on the outside of the fish?
Okay, so we can start up at the head, and we can see a little bit of their mouth right up here, and I'll probably take some tweezers in a little bit and open that up. And just above the mouth, we've got the eye, of course. Interestingly, the fish don't have eyelids. You guys can maybe think about why they wouldn't have any eyelids. But they do have that eye that you can see there. We also, just below that, if I tilt this guy up just a little bit, we can see their gill covering. So their gills are going to be right behind this slit right here. And right after that, we see their fins. So we start with those pectoral fins. We do have a dorsal fin up here, which you'll notice is a little bit compressed right now. It's flattened out.
And I can use the tweezers. Yeah. I have to use the little board over here so I don't get my fingers. Mm-hmm. But with the dorsal fins, the mackerel specifically, which is the one that we're dissecting today, actually have two dorsal fins. Isn't that right?
Yeah.
Isn't that what makes them different?
So we've got this over here and this little guy down here. There you go.
I thought there was another part up here. Maybe not.
It should be.
You kind of see it though.
Yeah. So you can see those guys.
And then you said the other fin. Now these are their pectorals, right? So we're going to be diving in and talking a little bit more about these, but just kind of to introduce you to the fish. This one right here really blends into the side.
Yeah.
So it's hard to see.
And you'll notice that as I'm moving this guy around, he's a bit shiny. And you'll see that the top is a different color than the bottom of the fish. So they do have a slightly different coloration. And you'll see that on most fish. And that's something called counter shading.
We'll be showing you and talking to you a little bit more about that as well.
Yeah.
Let's go and talk. Let's spend some time talking about the mouth. So in this case, right, we have that there's a mouth that's essentially pointing forward. Is that right?
Yeah. So he's a bit forward pointing. I don't know if you can see that there. There we go. If we do it that way.
So yeah, I can kind of open up for
you
too.
There.
So here's the mouth. There we go.
See?
Kind of angle it up a little bit.
There you go. I don't know if you guys can see that very well.
And we have some great pictures to go. So if we can actually first go to our first big picture, we'll show a picture of the mackerel first. So just so you can see what we're going to be dissecting today specifically. Can we go full screen on these? There we go. So yeah, there's the second dorsal fin. So this is what you're trying to point out too. Yep. So there's one dorsal fin. And then here's another. They've also got the pec, which is kind of spread out here, but it's kind of hard to see a little bit. Now, we were talking specifically about the mouth here, and you can see that the mouth is pointed forward quite a bit. Now, just kind of cool, I think, if we can come back to the overhead view, Cassandra's got that mouth spread out really nicely. Can we go to the overhead camera there?
Yeah.
There we go. Yeah, so that's a really big opening mouth. Now, we can, it's kind of hard to see here, but there's a tongue in there. Is that right?
Yep. He's got, you can sort of see the reflection on that tongue, that silvery bit there. It's a little harder to see with this angle. Maybe you can see it that way.
So that's a little bit,
silver.
Yeah.
That's the tongue in there. And you can also see along the sides of the mouth as I stretch it open. See how the sides expand
right
like
here.
That. Yeah.
You can see that just literally, like, I mean, their mouth is huge compared to what it looked like. Now, when the mouth is pointed forward, what does that indicate to us?
Well, that's going to tell us a bit about what these guys eat. So the direction of the mouth, that means that their food's going to be in front of them when they're eating. So these guys, they point forward, but there are other mouth shapes that they're going to have.
Oh, awesome. They got nice
fish.
And zoomed in there. That was really good. So there we go.
There we go. All right. So let me open that up. So he's going to be facing forward and his mouth's going to open wide. That means his food's going to be right in front of him. Whereas if you've got a mouth on the top or even underneath, then that means your food, you're looking for food that's underneath you if your mouth is pointed down. Or if your mouth is pointed up, that means you're sitting below the food and you're going to go after it as it swims over you.
And we have some good pictures of that as well. Can we go to our mackerel mouth picture 1 and 2, please, full screen? So there we go. Let me clear my little dots there. So these are just some close-ups, and then we go to the second picture. Basically exactly what we were showing you here, but just a little bit more still. And then we have a butterfly fish. Now here's an example of another type of mouth. So think about for a second, what maybe types of food would that type of fish eat based off of the mouth? And again, just like Cassandra was mentioning, there are some fish that have mouths pointed up, which means they're going to be eating food above them. There could be animals with mouths on the bottom, like a stingray, where we know that this food's going to be coming from below them. All right, so let's move on to the next part of the fish. You had mentioned earlier in passing about the gills and basically the plate covering that's on top of the gills, which is called the operculum.
Yeah, so we can see our operculum right here on the fish. That's going to be this right here. And you can look closely at a fish sometimes when they're swimming. You might see that move a little bit, but right behind it is where we're going to find our gills themselves.
And can you like flap open the operculum just to show a little bit?
Let's go ahead. Bit.
So it's like a little trap door almost, or like a little, not trap door, but like secret door.
Secret door.
Right, and then so we have all of the red part under there. That's the gills. We're going to be looking at the gills here in just a second. Now, can you describe, what does the operculum feel like compared to the rest of the body?
It's a bit more stiff, and it's got this outer covering. It's stiff right here, but it's more flexible down here. So just a little bit of a different feeling, whereas the rest of the body is a bit more squishy. You can kind of see that as I push against it as well. And you can see this kind of flaps open as one big flap and flaps shut again as one big flap.
Yeah. Okay, we're going to break just for a second. We have some questions. Ian, how long do we have to take the midterm? It'll be an hour, so you'll have an hour. It's a timed time test. There are, like I said, I believe there's 30 questions, 1 point each. That was for Jalene. And then Sage, can you go over the 3 main classes of fish one more time? Sure. So we have the class Ignathus, which are the lampreys. Class Chondrichthys, which are the sharks and rays. And then we basically have the bony fish. So I can never say it. Osteichthys.
Osteichthys.
So like osteoporosis, bones, right? So I always get stuck on that.
Osteichthys.
Osteichthys is the bony fish. So compared to a shark, their skeleton is not made out of bone, which is why they are in their own class.
Yeah.
And then for the osteichthys, there's about 18,000 different species, so quite a few. All right, Janisha, what determines the location of the gills that are developed on fish? For example, why would a fish develop gills towards the front half of the body as opposed to gills towards the back part of the body? I don't know of any fish that have gills towards the back part of the body.
No, I don't know of any either.
I don't know of any, Janisha, I'm not sure which fish would have gills in the back. We were talking about the mouths earlier, right? So the mouths are pointed down, front, and up. But as far as the gills, they're normally up towards the front there, and that's because some of the animals will use their gills for feeding, like a whale shark, for example. They use their gill, like parts of their gills, to filter out food that they then swallow. So it's usually always up towards the front. Also, that's going to be closer to where their heart is, very similar to how our heart and our lungs are in a very similar situation. Sydney, what is the purpose for the mackerel having two pectoral fins? So the pectoral fins are like the arm fins, one on the right, one on the left. I think what you're asking is why do they have two dorsal fins, which are the fins that are on the top? And usually that just helps with stability. We're going to be talking about fish shapes here in just a couple of minutes, and we'll kind of hit back on those dorsal fins when we talk about the fish shapes. All right, so going back to our operculum, there we are. So I don't know if we can, but maybe, Cassandra, you can cut off the operculum so we can take a look at some of the gills.
All right, so let's see if I'm able to get that out.
Or maybe we could just cut some of the gills out. Yeah. Whatever's easier. She's got the knife and stuff, I don't, so. Or the scissors.
Try to keep that centered there. All right, let's make sure that I'm getting under all the way. Let's first just try that.
You can really hear it crunching. I mean, it's really solid. It's like a little door. But that's important because the gills are a vital part of the fish's ability to survive.
All right. So there you can see that operculum. And it's still pretty solid. It's still got a good chunk to it. And then you can just see these gills. I'm going to try see if I can
spread them out a little bit.
Spread it out without tearing through them. Sometimes you can.
So now it's almost like pages in a book, right? There are multiple layers of gills here.
There's a number of layers right there.
And the gills are used to help fish breathe, right?
Yes. So this is going to have water flowing over it. And the operculum actually helps them control that water flow over their gills and makes it so that they can open and close it. And like a valve that's going to draw the water over the gills. And these gills are going to get the oxygen out of the water and help them breathe. And you can see the gill arch in there. I think that light allows you to see it a little bit. And so that's a pretty firm arch that helps support the frill of that gill. And that's what they use to get the oxygen out of the water.
Can we cut one of those gills out and take a look? Yeah. We have some pictures too. But just because we have a nice good close-up and the light's really good right now, we're just going to try and cut this out. Let you guys see it like you're dissecting it with us. So while you're cutting that out, Burgundy, since this fish is gray and silvery, silvery white, or what does this mean when they swim in more of a pelagic zone of the ocean as opposed to the bright colored reefs? Well, their color, just like their mouths tell us a lot, their colors tell us a lot too, that these are probably going to be more open ocean swimming animals because they're going to blend in a little bit better. If they were brightly colored, that would indicate that they were more in the reef. So this tells us that they're actually more open water where there's not a lot of colors reflecting. And we'll talk about that counter shading in just a little bit too. So we've got some of the gills cut out here.
There we are. These right up here. I got two of them, so you can really see that structure. And this is the solid structure. If you were listening while I was cutting, you heard that snip and snip. So the solid structure of the gill arch right here, and then that fringe that allows them to extract the oxygen from the water to help them breathe. You can see how red these are. And the red color is going to come from the blood that's inside of them. And it's much like our lungs.
So it's also rich in iron, right? Yes. Because iron is what the oxygen binds to move oxygen around the body. So we have some really cool pictures of the gills. So if we can go to our mackerel gills, we have two pictures. So it's picture number 4. So again, there's the book gills, and there's what they look like when they're pulled out and with that structure. Now, what we're seeing in this picture here, these almost like little strings, those are the gill rakers. That's what's going to help filter out some of the food it could potentially filter out some of the food there. And that's more advanced on some of the animals like the whale shark that do more filter feeding. Oh, yeah, you got some right there. Yeah. We're looking at our dissection part here. She's going to try and pull some out.
Kind of a little bit deeper down into that. Let me see if I can center that on the camera real fast. All right, so you can see these gill rakers right up here. I pulled them out from the main cavity of the gills. So all these fronds right through here.
Perfect. All right, so moving on from the gills, why don't we go back and talk about some of the fins again and kind of what the purpose of these fins are. So we identified the dorsal fin on the top. We had a question about that. But because this fish is a pretty quick-moving fish, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. So that means that they've got a nice fusiform body shape, which we'll talk about. But the dorsal fins essentially help to stabilize them. Is that right?
Yes. So it's going to help them out in the ocean. When you're in the ocean, of course, you've got different currents. You've got fast-moving water, different places. So these fins at the top and at the bottom are going to help to stabilize the fish. You can think of it a little bit like the rudders on a ship as well. You can see those.
Kind of make them out there on the bottom.
Make it out just a little bit on that anal fin there.
And then the pectoral fins, what are those used for?
The pectoral fins, they're used differently in different fish, and primarily this type of fish is going to use them a little bit for stabilization and a little bit for steering. But there are some fish that even use their pectoral fins for propulsion.
So this fish, which fin does this fish, or which fin does this fish use? There we go, that's a tongue twister. Which fin does this fish use to propel itself forward?
Ah, that's going to be the tail.
We'll move that a little bit.
We can see that over here. All right, so you can see this. And you'll notice it is one of the biggest fins on this fish. So that's just an interesting point of reference. But the tail also has a unique shape. There are different shaped tails for different fish, and that's going to tell us a little bit about the fish, isn't it?
And we would call this one forked.
Yes.
So a forked tail indicates to us that this fish is able to have quick bursts of speed, but it can't necessarily sustain it very long. Mm-hmm. So we would say, like, this is a sprinter, not a marathon runner.
Yes.
Yeah. All right, so we have some videos, and just like you mentioned, Cassandra, there are a couple of different types of fish. Some fish, in this case of the mackerel, use their tail to propel themselves forward. Other fish use their pectoral. So we're going to give you examples and show you videos of both. The first one that we're going to look at is going to be tuna swimming. They use their caudal fin, and this is true that most fishes use the caudal fin to propel them forward. But again, some, like wrasses, for example, will use their pectoral fins to propel them forward. So we're going to watch both. First, let's go to the video of the tuna swimming, please. Perfect example there. And then again, these guys have forked tails too.
Their fork's a little bit different.
A little different, yeah.
It's got more of a crescent shape to it.
All right, and if we can go to the wrasse swimming, take a look now at how they're using their pectoral fins in this one. All right, so you can see that there's a little bit of a difference there. All right, let's talk about the scales now. So fish, one of the characteristics that make, well, actually, hold on, sorry, Mackenzie had a question. Let's go to Mackenzie's question first. Are the gills of fish all that similar red color, no matter the type of fish that they are? Is that red color of the mackerel significant? All gills are going to be red like that, right?
Yeah.
In the case of totally not a fish, but talking about a horseshoe crab, for example, they're known because they have blue blood, and that's because instead of having iron as the main oxygen binding element, they use copper, and copper gives off blue where iron gives off red. But again, that's not a fish at all, but just as an example of, there are animals that do have different colors, but fish are all using iron, so they've got that rich red color. Okay, so one of the characteristics that makes fish a fish is that they all have scales.
Yes.
And these guys have scales too. I think it's a little bit hard to tell here from this picture or from our fish, but we can, I don't know, can we see any? Not really, huh?
Not, I mean, maybe on a very close zoom, you'd be able to see a little bit of at least the scaling pattern. So basically up close, it's going to look a lot like very tight shingles. You can see as the light reflects a little bit, you can kind of see those lines.
No, it's different than the dark colored lines. That's just the pattern of the fish.
That's just the pattern of the fish.
But you're trying to look for like the little, almost like clear. scales. But you've probably, if you've ever eaten fish or you've prepared fish, are probably familiar that you get scales everywhere. I know our husbandry folks that take care of animals at the aquarium are constantly getting scales all over them. Yes. And different fish will shed their scales in different ways. And there are more than one type of scale, isn't that right?
Yes. So there's three types, the ganoid, the cycloid, and the ctenoid. And they're all used for protection. They're all different ways that the fish have of protecting themselves.
So it'll literally like protect their body. It's like not fingernails all over the body, but it's almost, you know what I mean? It's not like skin. It's not this like kind of flexible skin. They do have skin, but they've got a little bit of extra protection on top of them there.
Yeah, a little bit like armor.
Deborah, you can differentiate between male and female sharks based off of whether they have claspers or not. Do fish have something like that? You're absolutely right about that. So you can easily tell sharks and rays apart based off of whether or not they have claspers. And we'll talk to you about that next week if you're not familiar with what we're talking about. But what about with fish?
Not so much. Not so much.
Unless there's like a big difference between the way a male and a female looks. Like a lot of times when you have sexually dimorphic fish. So where... like wrasses, right?
Yeah.
Like, which
it
we're going to talk
very
about.
Very different.
Yeah, very, very different. But other than that, like mackerel, mm-hmm. the only way we would really know is what? By cutting it, looking at the bottom. So
looking in it.
There's not really an easy way like there are for sharks and rays.
They're very sexually dimorphic fish, and they're also ones that are subtly different. So maybe the females are slightly bigger than the males. Or sometimes when a female is gravid, when she has full eggs, you can tell at that point because her body shape becomes a little bit different.
And I'm sure depending on species, there's other easy ways to tell, like if someone is working at a salmon hatchery, they're going to know how to mix the male and the female. I don't know all the fish, but it's not easy like claspers. So, okay, let's talk about the shape. Now, we mentioned their fins helping them move, but their body shape tells us a little bit about how fast of a mover there are and that kind of thing. So let's walk through the different body shapes of the fish as well. What is this one that we have here?
So this guy, you'll notice that the body shape, and that's just the overall whole picture of the body, they're going to be a fusiform shape. And so that's kind of what we think of when we think of fish. We usually think of the fusiform shape. If you draw a fish, it's that same shape. But there's also the depressed shape of a flat fish.
Well, actually, before you move on, I was going to say, we have pictures. So let's go look at the fusiform shape. If we can pull up picture number 5, please. This is, I think, a giant sea bass. Black sea bass, yeah.
Yeah.
Yes. So it's kind of football-shaped, right? So it's like a football. It's not skinny. He's pretty robust all the way around. So from this side of him to this side of him, it's pretty thick as well. So literally, like, imagine like a football. And that's what we're seeing here with our mackerel. And then the next one that you said is a depressed shape. So if we can pull up our next picture. Tell me what's the difference here?
So these depressed fish are going to be flat, and they're going to be able to bury themselves in sand, usually living on the bottom of the ocean. Rays would be a good example, halibut or other type of flat fishes would also be a pretty good example.
Oh, that's all that comes to mind for me, like flat fishes, like halibut and turbots and soles, and then rays. So I always... just to kind of help me remember that a fish that gets stepped on and becomes flat is depressed. So, right? Like he's depressed because he got smushed. Now, obviously, that's not how these animals got flat. This is their natural body shape. But it's this idea that if you get, you know, you get smushed on, that you're going to get depressed. And so it's depressed body shape. Compressed is different, right? So we've got smushed from top to bottom, and then compressed is smushed. What looks like it is smushed from side to side, so they're very skinny if you were to look at them straight on.
Yeah, and they're usually the fish that are going to be swimming in and out of cracks and crevices. Here you've got a surgeon fish, which likes to wedge itself between rocks and cracks. So you're going to find a lot of those skinny fish living
From here to here is very skinny.
Yeah.
Right? So if I were a predator, there's our textbook fish, rawr, right? And I were looking at that fish head on, because it's so skinny, it actually is a form of camouflage, where it's hard to see them if they're like eye to eye. What else do we have?
We've also got ribbon shaped. So speaking of fish that can go in and out of cracks and crevices easily, the eel is built to do that. They can actually back into crevices and come out of them. And they're going to be that long ribbon shape, usually in caves, rocks, and crevices, and they're designed to chase fish out of those areas as well, because they're looking for the fish that hide inside of the rocks.
So yeah, and their body like kind of wiggles around, right? So it's not going to be rigid. Fish that have that are kind of long and rigid actually have their own shape, and that's rod shaped, right?
Yes.
So like a barracuda, our next picture, is a perfect example of rod shape. So there's not going to be a lot of bending in this body here. It's pretty straight, and it's going to maintain that straight composure. And they're oftentimes an ambush predator, is that right?
Yes, and very, very fast moving. Again, in those spurts of speed.
Right, so their body, if you think about it, is meant to just cut right through the water very quickly to eat their prey.
Yeah.
Jacqueline has a question. What are the three different types of scales again, and how are they different?
Right, so we have the ganoid, the cycloid, and the tenoid scales. I don't know if you have any
I don't have any pictures. We could probably look some pictures up on break and show them to you. Basically, like, it's just the way the scale fits,
yeah.
Right? The way the scale looks is a little bit different. And we'll see if we can pull up, because I know that I'm sure that there are images on Google,
yeah,
where it shows like a slide view, like a microscope view of the different scales. So we can try and pull that up.
Yeah, it'll be a little bit easier to see the difference when you can see the picture of the scale and see how that lays out.
Now, talking about coloration, a couple of times that we've mentioned this counter shading idea. Mm-hmm. Walk me through, because we can see it here pretty nicely on this fish as well. But what is counter shading?
And so counter shading is a form of camouflage, and it's basically where the top of the fish is going to be a much darker color and the underside of the fish is going to be a much lighter color. So you can see that there in the overhead view pretty well. You can see how light it is here and how dark it is here. And when you're thinking about being a fish in a three-dimensional environment, you're thinking about the fact that there are predators underneath you, and there are predators that might be up above, or if you are a predator, there might be prey underneath you and predators from and prey that you're going to attack from underneath. So you want to be able to blend in with your surroundings, and many of the fish, but also even birds and other animals that you're going to find in the open ocean, they're going to have this type of counter shading. And that's going to allow them to blend in with the ocean depths. If something's looking at it from up above, think about looking down into the ocean. It's a dark, dark area, especially if you're looking in deep waters. So the dark coloration is going to help them blend in down below when something's looking at them from up above. And if you're thinking from the other side, if you're thinking of something swimming underneath them, it's looking up into the light, and this lighter coloration is one of the ways that the fish is going to just blend in, or at least disguise its body shape a little bit. Sometimes camouflage isn't so much about disappearing entirely as it is about just trying to disguise what shape you might have.
Sure. And with like some other fish, right? So we know that obviously, like you said, fish are gonna wanna camouflage. But this can also help them, especially this guy being like a silvery fish, right? This tells us a little bit about like schooling behavior, right?
Yeah.
So the schooling behavior confuses the predator and gives these fish a greater chance of survival. You got a bunch of silver things flashing, 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 flashing. It's hard to narrow down. If you're playing a game of tag, right? Like everyone's like, go, and you've got all of your friends around you and everyone's kind of close to you, you end up like going this way and then you go that way and then and then everyone kind of disperses and gets away, versus like finding that one, narrowing down that one person that you're going to go after. That's why the schooling behavior kind of helps, and with all these silver flashes, it's hard to like identify that one and go after that one that you want. So it's a really cool way of survival. Another fish that has amazing camouflaging techniques is the flatfish, right? So why don't we take a look at our flatfish? Can we go full screen on this? We're not going to spend a ton of time talking about the whole morphosis of the flatfish right now, because that's going to come later. But just the idea, I'm sure you can probably see the eyes here. But there's like all the little stringy parts here of the fish. And then it goes around like that. So that fish is just blending in perfectly to its surroundings.
And he's laying on his side, isn't he?
Yes, so laying on his side, we'll talk about that once we get to this area in just a little bit. Gabe, did those fish evolve to get this camouflage shade? Yeah, I mean, over time, this is definitely an adaptation that they have that helped them survive.
Absolutely.
All right, how are we doing on time? So we are at 3:35 right now. We're gonna take a break a little bit early because what we're gonna do while we're on break is we're gonna cut into the fish. Well, they're gonna be getting the break ready here in a second. We're gonna be cutting into the fish. So actually, while we're waiting for them to get ready, why don't we do the question, or not the question of the day, the mystery item. Hold on just a second. So if we can go to our camera. Oh, now they're ready. Hold on, let's just show it real quick. Let's go to my computer in here. And this is gonna be our mystery item of the day. So I wanna know what it is that we're looking at. Now I know obviously that this is a type of animal. I don't want you to give me the general name of the animal. I wanna know specifically what type of animal this is. We will show this again after break, but for some participation points, you can email in your answer or call live to the show for 2 participation points. Just knock them out for the day. So either one will do. And again, we'll show this when we get back from the break here in just a minute. So, all right, so we'll take a 5-minute break while we cut into our fish and we'll go look at the internal anatomy. If you have any questions about the external anatomy, we do have another fish in here that we can reference if we need to in case we've already diced it up. So don't feel like you are missing out if we haven't gotten to that yet. So, all right, 5-minute break to take a break or stand up, stretch, get a snack, all that kind of stuff. Don't worry, it's not too gross in there. So hopefully it won't be any like barf worthy or anything like that. So, all right, we'll see you in about 5 minutes.
State University, Dominguez Hills.
Life today. where STEM happens. This is where STEM comes alive.
Because most of my friends from high school were attending other universities within the area, I wanted to branch off and establish my own network. And that's exactly what I found here at Dominguez Hills, a great network.
Enrich your life. Increase your earning potential. Cal State Dominguez Hills offers a master's degree in the humanities. With a focus on the cities of the world, this master's degree can be earned in as little as 5 semesters. Evening classes are available for your convenience. Why wait? Call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
All right, welcome back. So I don't remember who it was that asked about the, who asked about the different scales. Sorry, I forgot. But I did find something. If we can go to the computer, I found this just by doing a quick search. This is from Britannica. If we go to the computer, there we go. So these are the different scales. Now the only one that we haven't talked about so far today are basically the shark scales. That's because that's next week. But these are the ones that we were talking about as far as how they look a little bit different and they lay a little bit differently as well. Yeah. There we go. So not too bad. So there it gives you an idea of how the scales are a little bit different.
So the ones with the biggest difference between the two are the ganoid and the cycloid and tenoids.
And these two.
So the cycloid and the tenoids, those are probably pretty close to what you already think of as scales. They lie on top of each other like roofing shingles. They've got a bit of a roundish shape. The tenoids are a little bit more three-dimensional. They've got kind of a ridge to them. The ganoids, they do overlap slightly, but they have more of a diamond shape, and they do stick up in the middle. So you're going to find that on agar or other, usually more river-going fish.
Perfect. All right, so coming back to our mystery item for today. So we have some guesses. Mackenzie, is it a trigger fish? Good guess, but not a trigger fish. Shannon, Jacqueline, Sage, Josh, and Deborah all guessed if it is a Garibaldi, specifically a juvenile Garibaldi, and you are correct. Jaleen and Lena, is it a blue dot grouper? I can totally see why you would see that, but it is not that. So it is, in fact, a juvenile Garibaldi. This is what they look like when they're babies. Now, when they get really big, they will be all orange. We have some pictures of them a little bit later. But this is actually, these blue dots are very significant. Why is that? Well, actually, no, we can't really say. We actually can't really say, because that's going to give a hint into our question of the day. Wow. Maria, I saw your thing come up. So we already said the Garibaldi. I think you said something with a coral grouper, but I got swiped away too soon. But just wanted to acknowledge that I didn't see that. So actually, from this, let me show you another one. There's another example of a baby. They have this like neon blue. Now, this is not something that the adults have. Only the juveniles have that. And you'll be able to learn a little bit more about that when you look up the question of the day. So I think if we talk about the blue, we're going to give too much away.
I think so.
Okay. So, so let's move right into our question of the day. And it's basically, why are Garibaldis bright in color? So we'll have that pull up here in just a second. There we go. But one thing to point out is that Garibaldi, if you're not familiar with the Garibaldi, is our state marine fish. Now remember that we have kelp forests off of our communities, or off of our coast here. And that makes it interesting because Garibaldis are bright orange. They're definitely not going to be blending into the kelp forest.
Nope.
So it makes them a little bit special.
They stand out like sore thumbs. And if you take a boat to Catalina or you go to any of the local marine reserves, you're going to see those Garibaldi, and they're probably going to be one of the first things you see.
You'll notice them easily from the boat looking down into the water, because they are so brightly colored. So we want to know why. Why is that? What is that all about? And while you're looking that up, you might also find out why the juveniles have that neon blue on them.
Yeah.
All right, so now that we are back, we are going to dive into the insides of our mackerel here. So we were able to cut it off. I think it's kind of cool. We should probably point out like where the meat is that people eat.
Sure.
Right, as well as everything else. So we're going to go to the above camera again to show you what the insides look like. This is obviously very different from say the squid that we looked at. Now remember, squid don't have blood like this guy does here.
Yeah, so you were first talking about the meat. You can kind of see that up here. It's the least bloody looking of what we have here. And you can see a little bit of that musculature there. So the muscle structure, that's usually when you think of fish in general, you're thinking of kind of that flaky texture or that flaky look. That's their muscle structure.
So just to point out too, can you flip it closed again so we can
sure.
tell them how we,
oh,
like
yes.
just show them how we cut it, right? So we basically windowed it where we cut from the bottom up to the operculum, then we went up to the top, mm-hmm. down the back. And so that's like we just basically kind of pulled off that muscle, which is the part that everyone would eat. Mm-hmm. And now we're gonna be looking nice and closely at the inside parts here.
Yep. I'm just pulling back a little bit more of that so you can see a little bit more of that classic
pink
flaky
flesh, right?
Pink flesh. And you can also see that skin. So you can see a little bit of the silvery part and a little bit of the scales coming off. So you can kind of see that a little bit better.
Now we got a bloody mess going on in here, but let's see if we can start to point out. We have pictures, so don't worry if you can't totally make it out right this moment. We will be going back and forth between pictures with a little bit better lighting, less glare, and what we see here. So Cassandra, walk me through some of the parts that we see here.
All right, so right under where we have the flesh, I'm just gonna pull these guys out because it's neat to see them like this. These are the ribs. So this is a bony fish. And
I wonder if there's a way,
a little bit.
Let me see, hold on, I'm gonna grab a tissue. Or
all
no,
right.
What do I have back here? Let's see if I put this under
white,
it.
Yeah. Just to see that contrast. My fingers might work, but
let's see.
All right. So I'm trying to be a little bit delicate too, because we'll get to the fun part in a minute. Underneath these ribs, underneath these bones that you see, we've got the swim bladder. So it is still intact, which is not always the case. Sometimes you open up a fish oftentimes you open up a fish and the swim bladder has already popped. So we're gonna be able to see that swim bladder and we'll pop it open.
So these are the ribs that we're looking at here.
Yeah, and so they attach up here to the spine. You can see just a little bit of that spine. It's a little bit harder to see because it's down under the flesh there. It is right in there where the tweezers are pointing. Can see that bone there. So we've got that bony fish. I'm going to pull this out a little and we'll take a look at some of the internal structure. So we already talked a little bit about the gills. There's the gill rakes a little bit more clearly up here at the front, and then right behind that and right below that, in addition to a few more gills, we can see the heart.
So it's kind of hard to see here with the glare, so we'll just see if we can really a dark, rich red,
yeah.
right where her tweezers
right
are.
Where the tweezers are.
Can we go to the picture of the heart? That might be a little bit better. We'll see. There we go. Can we go full screen? There we go. So we're looking at it's this really just dark red part there. All right. Now, as we know, the heart is what's responsible for pumping blood all around the fish's body.
Mm-hmm.
And then next, kind of very close to that, is the liver. Can we see that part?
A little bit. All right, so there we are.
We'll wait for the above head view here.
So I'm pulling it out just a little bit, so you can see the heart a little bit more clearly against the stained paper plate, but it is this part right here. And then we've got a bit of liver.
And the liver, just like our liver, it's helped with toxins mm-hmm. and basically filtering out things from the food. So that's right under all that like stringy spaghetti looking stuff.
I'm just gonna get my fingers in there for it. All right, so you can see if I tilt it this way for the light. So you can see that liver part right there. That's where my thumb is.
Right, yeah, and we also have a picture of the liver, so if we can go to number 13. Oh yeah, that's a good view there too, Cassandra. Looks good.
Yeah. All right, so this whole area there.
Yeah, we can go full screen on the liver. So again, kind of another part. Now just looking at this picture real quick, you can see all the stringy parts right above the liver. And what is that?
Oh, that is...
That's the cica, right?
Cica, yes.
And that just helps with digestion. Mm-hmm. You can see it on our fish here as well. We can come back to our camera.
Yeah.
We're making everyone in the studio go back and forth, back and forth, back and forth.
So the cica, and it's, I don't know if you can see it too well on the camera, but it's not quite as dark red in color. It's a bit stringy, it's brown. You can see it kind of attached to the liver over here. So my tweezers have the liver right now, and then the cica is right here. And when the fish was laying flat, here we go, it kind of pulls out a little bit, and we can see now that it's also attached to the intestines.
So just barely make out the intestines here. Yeah.
Won't be able to make those out.
I wonder if we can cut it out. You want to try and cut it out?
Yep, let's try.
So we're getting some questions about whether or not this is a male or female mackerel, and we're going to get to that in just a second. We're going to try and cut the cica out, and we hopefully will be able to see the, oh, it's leaking, yeah.
Leaking. Always fun when things leak.
Oh, you can see part there where the intestine is there, yeah.
Yeah, there's some intestines right there. You can see that there.
And if we were to trace this, we could literally trace this to the stomach.
Yep.
Here, pull the cica back towards me. Yeah, and then you can really see. Here, let's move it this way a little bit. Oh, can you go back, please? There we go. There we go. So this right here is the intestine.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
That is sticky.
You'll notice I'm wearing gloves.
That's why I'm making her do all this.
See if I can isolate that intestine as well.
That's kind of fun, right?
All right. So that's part of the intestines and the cica there. Let's see. You can sort of start to see those different pieces of the cica. Almost looks like very thick hairs, or if you're used to looking at sea anemones, it looks a little bit like a sea anemone's tentacles.
Yeah, no, that looks like a good description.
Yeah, not all related.
Anna, is it true that since fish don't have a neocortex in their brain, they can't feel pain? I think that they can feel pain, right?
They respond to stimulus that would be painful.
Right.
So it might depend upon your definition of pain. Or your definition of feeling pain. Mm-hmm. They might not feel pain the way that we feel pain, but they do respond to stimulus that would cause pain. They also respond to stimulus like heat or cold, so they definitely have sensations like that.
Right. What is cica and how do you spell it? So it is spelled C-A-E-C-A, and it's basically just part of the digestion system. There's a lot of surface area with it, and I don't, like, what is it? I don't remember what exactly, like, what part of the nutrients does it?
I don't remember exactly which nutrients. I know I have heard it compared to parts of our intestines,
yeah.
So essentially a less advanced intestine area, just filtering out more nutrients.
All right, and so on the inside here, now that we're kind of going to go back to the middle of, actually, hold on, we can stop and take a look. Well, we're going to be looking at the fish stomach next, so can we pull up the fish stomach picture, please? It's number 15. So you can kind of see it there between the,
that that guy's already got a popped swim bladder.
Yeah.
That's why it's...
We're going to see if we can try and find here. Well, unless... Let's see. Oops, I almost popped our swim bladder. We're trying to see. So we might have to pop the swim bladder first. So coming back to our picture here. I'm sorry, our above view camera if we can. There we go. We're going to show you what the swim bladder is. Now, what is the swim bladder? Like, if you look when we see it from above here, you'll notice it's all filled with air.
Yeah. So. And that air is very important. So if you're a scuba diver or if you're even just any kind of animal that's trying to go underwater and come up and regulate where in the water you're located.
Just push on it so we can see, right? So you can see that it's
right there. So it's full of air. That air is very important because it's going to help them regulate their buoyancy. It's going to help them determine where in the water column they're going to be located. And a lot of times the swim bladder will pop. I'm going to pop this guy now, I hope. Here we go. Well, a lot of times it pops even before you get to the dissection. And that's because air is going to expand as it comes up from down below. You can just see it doesn't have much structure anymore. It's a very thin membrane to hold that air in. I'm stretching it out a little bit, so I don't know if that's showing very well. Let's see if I can stretch it against a white area.
So basically, kind of coming back to the whole idea of buoyancy, right? The fish doesn't want to have to exert energy to sit in the water column. So that means that they're going to try and regulate how much air is in their body to help them float exactly where they are. That means that if they want to go deeper, they want less air. They can regulate how much air is in that buoyancy or in the swim bladder so they can sink. If they want to go up more towards the surface, they can regulate that air so there's more air so it helps them float. So basically, it's all about a conservation of energy, and that's going to help them be able to sit in the water column basically where they want to. Now, that doesn't mean that they can go down to really deep seas. Like that, you have to be adapted in many other ways to do that, but just within the basic water column, going from 5 feet to 10 feet is different buoyancy. You're gonna have to regulate a different type of air.
Yeah, exactly.
Are we able to get to the stomach? I can't tell.
You know, I realized, I think,
it's we
right
chop it
in here. We may have chopped it in half, or it may be right here.
So with the stomach contents, it's kind of fun to cut, because then we can see what they've been eating.
I think it's this guy here. I think I pulled it out with the intestine.
Oh, yeah, that might make sense, huh? Yep. Well, it looks like he probably did not eat very much.
Nope. He's got a very thin stomach. Every once in a while, you can see remains inside the stomach.
We'll pull out piles of scales and...
There's a little bit in there. There you go.
Yeah. So we can see if you go to the plate or the above view, we can see some of the stuff here.
So, yeah, I'll move it over. Sorry, I pulled the stomach over here. And this area in here, this is basically what was in this guy's stomach. It's not too much. There's a little bit of green.
Maybe some plankton eaten.
Yeah, just a little bit. So that was all squeezed right out of here. Let me just scrape it a little bit more, see what else we've got. Nope, not much. So he had a pretty thin stomach. It came out with the intestines. We missed it.
Probably because it wasn't
Very big.
Now, we believe this is a male here based off of the test. Well, let's see. If we pull them out, we'll be able to tell you for sure. We saw them down in the bottom. Oops, let's make the plate here.
Oh. Okay, so. Oops.
We saw them earlier. But basically, we literally had to look for the testes. So we had little long pink parts. But instead, since this guy, I think it's kind of in the back there.
Yeah.
Let's go to our picture. We can have fish stomach and testes. If we can pull that picture up, it's number 17. Here, this is all the scales we pulled out of a stomach on one that we dissected at the aquarium. And then right here, those are the very swollen testes. So this fish was ready to spawn. We actually have a question about that from Cynthia. How do fish have intercourse, or how do they mate? So this is sexual reproduction. That means that we have sperm and eggs basically coming together. But a lot of times it's all external fertilization. So for example, the males are going to release sperm, the females are going to release eggs, and it's going to come together. We're actually going to go over that next. So we're going to talk a little bit about the different forms of reproduction within the fish. Okay. Araceli, how do fish sleep? Not like us, right? It's a little bit different.
Yeah, it's quite a bit different. And different fish are going to have a little bit different sleeping pattern. So there are some fish that do actually stop moving and sleep, the surgeon fish being one of them. So that's pretty funny. When the lights go out, they sort of sink to the bottom, lie on one side, and they're just sitting there and they're sleeping. But there are many other fish that are going to be deep water fish. They don't have a place to curl up and take a nap. They just have to keep swimming. So
yeah, like parrotfish are another one. Like they remember we talked about them. They create their own like little sleeping mucus. Bag of mucus. So different ways. So all right, we are pretty much done looking at the fish here. So we're gonna probably throw him back in the well, whatever. He smells them. We're gonna have him sit up here and smell this for the rest of the class. But anyway, so we're gonna move on. We're gonna talk about now some of the reproduction strategies. The first one that I mentioned was broadcast spawning, right? And so that's basically where they both just release their stuff externally, and the fertilization occurs outside of the body. And here's a little visual to show you. If we can pull that up, please, full screen. Oh, let me get rid of that. So we've got the female fish will lay her eggs, and then the male fish waits to spread sperm over the eggs, and that's where fertilization occurs. So the males and females do have to be somewhat the same area generally. That's gonna help the fitness of the eggs when they come together with the sperm. They can use this strategy and produce millions of eggs at a time, which of course, the more eggs you have, the better chances only a few, will survive. Lots of animals eat these fish eggs, right?
Yes, absolutely. They are a big source of food for many animals and even humans. Right. So you'll see caviar.
Yeah. And the majority of species using this means of reproduction are known to synchronize breeding with lunar cycles. So they have some kind of sensory that, hey, like it's time, and they'll all come together.
Yeah.
Aylin, is it true that the fishes have short-term memory? How does that work?
I don't think.
I mean, I've seen actually proven opposite of
that. Yeah, I've seen quite a few things proven that fish do have a longer term memory. They are able to remember different places. In fact, there are quite a few fish that depend upon a very basic memory, a memory of smell, mm-hmm. in order to find their home rivers. So salmon would be one of those. There's also quite a few studies that have been done on fish as to how things like ocean acidification affect their memory. Mm-hmm. And they're showing now that clownfish in particular are affected by that, and they lose their memory even of what a predator might smell like. And
right.
They'll swim towards a predator instead of away from it when the ocean becomes more acidic.
Huh. Interesting. I think that there's just a lot to learn.
Yeah.
You know, there's a lot that we don't know yet. And I think that people that would catch fish and dice them alive, I think enjoyed the idea that they don't feel it or they don't remember the pain. But we actually don't think we know that. So.
And there's an idea, I know a lot of times goldfish are referred to as having short-term memory, and you can actually train goldfish and other fish to do certain things and run certain patterns, and I think that primarily that comes from them doing the same thing, showing the same behavior over and over again,
mm-hmm.
and that doesn't necessarily indicate that they don't remember what they just did. It may indicate that they're just repeating that behavior.
Right.
So it could be different interpretations, mm-hmm. and also different interpretations, again, of what memory means. Is
right.
memory something that happened a long time ago when the fish was a fish fry? Is it something that happened yesterday? Is it something that happened 2 minutes ago? Those are all different subjects.
Sure, definitely. Shannon, what happens if the swim bladder ruptures while the fish is still alive?
Comes out of their mouth. usually. So you'll see it a lot in deep sea fishing, or if a fish is brought to the surface too quickly, the air does expand inside of the body, just like it would expand inside of a diver's body if a diver takes a breath of air down at depth and they don't continue to exhale. That would expand inside their lungs. Well, if a fish bladder has air in it and it's brought too rapidly up to the surface and it's not allowed to decompress, then usually it expands rapidly, and you'll see it a lot with deep sea fishing, and that the swim bladder comes out of the mouth.
And they basically die, right?
Yes.
I mean, they can't sustain that. Yeah,
they're either very injured or they die immediately.
Right. We do have a video coming back to the reproduction of some fish spawning. So if we can go to our fish spawning video, we have a cute little clip of some reproduction.
Oh boy.
No, basically just goes through and shows you how it's done. So if we can go to our fish spawning video, please. This is a National Geographic video that we found online.
Here in Yellowstone National Park, these cutthroat trout are rubbing against each other and quivering. They're about to spawn. The female expels a stream of eggs, and then the male ejects a cloud of sperm. The process continues for 4, even 5 times. A healthy female can lay 1,100 to 1,700 eggs that hatch in about 6 to 7 weeks. And while this looks like a talent show, these fish don't really sing. Their gaping mouths are actually a physiological response to all that pushing.
So kind of interesting, so they're spawning. There's also live birth. So some will actually hold the babies inside. So surf perch are an example of this. And then they give birth to like way more developed fish. Mm-hmm. So if we can show a picture of that.
And that gives them an advantage, right? It makes it easier for them to survive.
Right, yeah, because they don't have to do the larval stage. They don't have to do the, like, I mean, these are like basically full functioning small versions of themselves.
Yeah, and so they're a little bit bigger than the eggs, less vulnerable.
As far as parental care after birth, a lot of fish do not participate in the aftercare of the young. Basically, once, you know, obviously if they lay eggs and they fertilize them, then the mom and dads leave and they never see them again, whatever. But in some cases, there is some parental care, like in cardinal fish. They kind of have an interesting story, right?
Yeah, so they'll actually hold that the babies in their mouth, and they'll brood those babies, their mouth brooders.
So it's kind of hard to see here, but these are little babies right here in the mouth. So here's the mouth of the dad in this case, I think, right? Isn't it the male?
Yes, the male
broods?
Little
and then we
mouth
have little fishies in there.
Yeah.
Now, what about mate selection? In the case of like salmon, like or trout that we just saw, probably not a big deal. But there are some species that are very particular about their mates, right?
Yes. And basically, if you have fewer offspring, you're going to be much more selective about your mate because you want to make sure that your offspring are going to have the best chance of survival. So if you don't have as many, you're a bit more concerned about who you're choosing for a partner.
Right. A perfect example of that would be like the Garibaldi, right?
Yeah.
I think we're talking about the Garibaldi in a little bit. I thought we had. Then we have I had a picture of the nest.
Well, they do make nests. And in many cases, there are quite a few fish that will make nests. And usually it's the male making a nest, trying to bring the female on over. And so whether it's Garibaldi or clownfish or sometimes there are even fish that will make large patterns in the sand and attract their mate that way with these very fancy, fancy sand patterns.
Right. In the case of the Garibaldi, they have these nests that they create. So it's the male that creates the nest, and they like basically find a little area, and they'll decorate it, and they'll put like kelp in there, and like different types of seaweed, and they make it this nice little thing, and then the females will come in and check it out. And then, there we go, that's the picture I was looking for. I don't remember where it is here. But then they'll come check it out, and then eventually the female finds finds one that she likes and she lays the eggs in the nest. He fertilizes them, but then he chases her out because she'll eat the eggs. Yeah. And he knows that, and so he chases her out and then he guards that nest. So kind of interesting.
Yeah, they're very particular about that.
There is some interesting fish out there, like the wrasses, for example, that go through something where they will change sex. Yeah. So in the case of like the California sheephead, they're an animal that starts off female, and then they will, if there's no males in the area, basically change sex and turn into a male. Is that right?
Yes. So, and usually it's the strongest female that will actually change sex. So you will see this classic sheephead pattern, and there's one at the aquarium that we have. There are quite a few I've seen off of Catalina as well, and they've got that dark black head, bright red center.
Can we go full screen again on this one?
Yeah, you can see it back here.
So, real quick, but this is the female right here, right?
Yes.
Very different than, say, the male here. And so you're saying that with the male, they've got the black head.
Mm-hmm. Black head, orange or red stripe in the center, and then a black tail as well. So they've got kind of those three different colors. And what's interesting is as the female develops, the older females, they will start taking on that coloration. So they'll still be the shape of that female in the top right, but they will start to have the stripes showing.
So it'll go the black here, white here, and then black back here.
Yeah. So they'll start to display that coloration, and it gets stronger and stronger as the female grows.
Right. So kind of a fun story there. Now, when the females, we kind of see it in that bottom right picture there, those are two males, but they'll have the open mouth contest, right?
Yeah.
Where it's like two females, it's the two dominant females, and then they're trying to figure out, well, who's gonna change to become a male.
Yep.
And so whoever, like, it's whoever can open up their mouth the biggest or hold it the longest, right?
Hold it the biggest is what I remember.
Yeah, and why would animals change sex? What's the benefit of that?
Well, it ensures that the strongest genes are being passed along. So we have quite a few animals who will do it one way or another, either female turn into male or male turn into female. And it ensures that whoever's living the longest, whoever has had the best survival, is then going to be the one to pass on their genes. And that's going to ensure that the next generation is going to do that. There's also an advantage. It's interesting because the wrasses do it the opposite way, where female turns into male, but in many fish and other sea creatures, there's an advantage to having larger females. And so many times it'll go the other direction, where a male will turn into a female, because the larger the female, the more eggs they're going to produce, the older they are, and the stronger their eggs are going to be. So that's a very important survival technique.
And one of the reasons for that is because if you think about when a baby fish is born, right, like every time they eat, or, you know, when they're gaining energy, the energy is being put into two things, growing, and then when they become sexually mature, producing either sperm or eggs. Well, because their energy is still going into growing when they're small, it's much easier to produce sperm than it is eggs.
Yeah.
So the whole idea is while I'm still growing, I can be a male and produce this kind of cheap sperm. And then when I'm big enough and strong enough and I don't have to put any more energy into growing, all of my energy can go into producing eggs, which is why you'll see females later in life. But in the case of the wrasses, like you mentioned, it's opposite, where you're gonna have male or a female first, changing into the male, and it's gonna be the most dominant female. And that helps if there's no males around, the females can then take that place, whatever the strong female is. All right, so as far as some fun facts, we've talked a lot about fish in our ecosystem days when we're talking about like the Arctics and stuff like that, but there's some fun facts. Like fish can be found in water as cold as 28 degrees Fahrenheit, that's below freezing.
Yep.
And species of fish are found in pretty much every body of water throughout the world, right?
Yes.
Are there any ones that aren't that can come to mind?
The Dead Sea.
The Dead Sea, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's too salty.
Too salty, yeah.
No such thing as too fresh, but definitely
yeah,
too salty.
Definitely too salty. Fish can live for a few months up to a couple hundred years, such as the rockfish and koi. And not only do fish live in salt and fresh water, many fish can live in both, like the salmon, for example, or the trout that we saw that swim up the river, but then will live their adult life in the ocean. All right, so for the remainder of the time, about the next 12 minutes or so, we are going to be going over different types of fish. We've already talked a lot about parrotfish, so we can kind of quickly skim over them, but tell me about the parrotfish.
All right, so parrotfish, they have that name both from their beak and from their bright coloration. So their front teeth are actually fused together, forming this classic beak, and in the picture behind us, it's not quite as prominent. You can kind of see it
there, we go.
There in front. You can see actually the fusion of those teeth there, but I've certainly seen parrotfish that look like they have a classic parrot's beak on them, so this is probably a younger parrotfish. And I've even seen ones that their beak is so large that it's starting to grow moss off of it.
Wow.
And those two fused teeth are very important because they're going to chomp down on hard corals, and they're going to eat that coral. And then our favorite fact about parrotfish.
Yes, we showed a really cool video about this when we talked about them last time for Coral Reef Day.
So they're going to excrete sand, and that's going to make our nice, beautiful, white, sandy beaches.
So yes, and you should remember that from when we talked about that with our videos on the Coral Reef Day. So lots of sand due to these guys eating that coral, digesting that calcium carbonate, and giving us the nice white sandy beaches. Yeah.
So I mentioned their beaks, but they also get their name from their bright coloration. The parrotfish are going to have a multitude of different colors, usually somewhat pastel, although there are some that are bright red or bright green. And they tend to just be your kind of typical picture of a tropical fish at that point.
So Sydney actually had a question. Sorry, Sydney, I saw you up there a little while ago. I just hadn't gotten to it yet. Why don't fish have eyelids?
Well, we talked a little bit earlier about fish sleeping, and one of the main reasons for eyelids is to protect the eye while you are sleeping. So they're not having eyelids because they're not necessarily sleeping. Another main benefit of the eyelid is to rehydrate the eye, and we do that when we're blinking, coming from our tear ducts, and fish don't really need to do that. However, you might learn next lesson about some fish that do have eyelids. They're not bony fish, though.
They're not bony fish, so stay tuned for that one.
Hey.
Kimberly, how is the age of fishes determined?
Ooh, very good question.
From their ears.
Their ears.
Yeah,
they have
ear
a little ear bone,
and
that ear bone, as the fish develops every year, rings form on it. So it's a little bit like the rings on a tree.
Like on a tree.
And you can measure the age of a fish based upon the rings in their ears.
We normally, that actually used to be one of our mystery items, was identifying the bone, but it was hard.
Yeah, that's really
hard.
So
it was really hard, so we axed that one. It
takes a lot of Googling.
All right, so the next type of fish we're going to talk about are the puffer fishes. These guys can inflate with water or air. They have scaleless skin, which is a little bit different, and they have beak-like dental plates as well. Now, this is different than porcupine fish. So porcupine fish are kind of like puffer fish, but puffer fish have a
tetrodotoxin.
There you go. So it's a type of toxin, basically, in their body, which is why when it is prepared, there are certain parts of the fish that you're not supposed to eat because it's poisonous.
Yes.
But they can inflate up to 12... Wait, no, wrong one.
The poison is 1,200 times more poisonous than cyanide.
Yeah.
So it's a serious poison. But they're still a delicacy. They're still eaten as food. They're prepared very, very carefully. It's usually as fugu. And they have chefs that are specially licensed to slice these guys up and make sure that only the correct part of the fish is served. And right. It causes your tongue to tingle a little bit. And
How do you know if you got the toxin or not? I don't know.
It's partially the toxin that makes it tingle. You can't have too much of it.
I'm not even going to mess with it.
No, I wouldn't mess with it either.
We have a bunch of questions if we can go back to the top here. Daisy, when fish die, is it like humans when we are still brain active for a few moments or no? I think so.
Probably.
Right? Probably. I mean, I don't know. I don't kill fish. I don't. I'm not a fisher, so.
Yeah.
We could probably search that and find out. I'm actually not sure, though. Anna, do fish have menstrual cycles or something similar to the setch? No, because remember that, like, for example, in mammals, right, like all of the internal incubation, right, is the baby is getting nutrients from the mom. And so that's the environment that is set up each month for the baby if an egg becomes fertilized. In the case of fishes, right, remember it's all basically external. In the case of the perch, that do internal, is, I don't know if that's internal.
It's primarily more like an internal fertilization, and then they
But there's still eggs,
there's
right?
There's still eggs.
There's still eggs that have to be fertilized. We're actually going to talk a little bit more about that with sharks next week.
Yeah.
But again, they're not getting the nutrients from their moms. Yeah. So there's, and it's not like they're preparing every month for it.
At most, what you're going to get is perhaps the laying of eggs that don't get fertilized right. afterwards. So the eggs will still continue to be laid even if there's no male around to fertilize them yeah. in most cases.
Right. Alien, is there a fish big enough to eat a human? Big enough? Yes. Do they? No. Like, for example, there's the Mola Mola, the biggest bony fish, which is 5,000 pounds, but they eat jelly. So they could. I mean, they're big enough yeah. to, but they don't. Janisha, clownfish change gender as well, right? Yes. At what point in their lives would they make the switch? I think that really depends on food availability, yes. right? And how fast they're able to grow. If it takes them a long time to grow, they're not going to be switching very fast. Yeah. If there's lots of food abundant, then a little bit more time.
It also depends upon whether or not the gender is present. So
right.
in the case of Nemo, Nemo's dad would have turned into his mom.
Right, yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, so coming back to the puffer fishes, we do have a video. If we can watch this video of a puffer fish, it's really cool because it talks about this otter and it shows what happens, and I think it's a really fun story. So if we can watch our puffer fish video.
Sometimes a defeat can really be a victory. Let's begin with this puffer fish, minding its own business in this calm river delta in Tanzania, Africa. Enter the predator. In this case, a river otter cousin to the Yellowstone sliders. It's trying to make an afternoon snack out of the pufferfish. Huh, how tough could it be? The otter captures the puffer. Well, sort of. I mean, you know, not exactly. Okay, the truth is the puffer gulps water until it resembles a beach ball, and in the process, transforms from a tasty morsel into a major pain. No matter what the otter tries, the puffer refuses to deflate himself. Naturally, the otter appears baffled. He set out to get a fish dinner, and instead he seems to be playing a ball game. The irony here is that the puffer is protecting both of them. The puffer has a poisonous gallbladder. If the otter actually ate the puffer, they'd both die. Puff Daddy survives, and the otter goes in search of another meal it can sink its teeth into.
So there you have it.
There you go.
So perfect example. So there's our puffer fish friends. All right, now in our last couple of minutes, I really want to get to this temperate species. So these ones have been a little bit different, but specifically I want to talk about flatfish that we saw earlier that camouflage really well. Now, Cassandra, walk me through. This would be like halibut, flounder,
yeah.
Soles, turbots. They're very special, right?
They are, and they're special because they basically start off just like any other fish. They're going to have two eyes, one on each side of their head, but they end up picking a side and lie down on that side. When they do that, their eye actually migrates over and they undergo some physiological changes. Their mouth shifts a little bit, and they will spend the rest of their lives either as right-sided or left-sided fish.
So they start normal.
Mm-hmm.
So they, like when they're hatchlings, right, they look like a little normal fish, but eventually they end up turning to one side. And the eye that was on this side that now is going to be on this side, so both eyes are on this side like this, literally migrates,
yeah.
right? Like in some cases through the skull
yep.
or over the top,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
And then they get that counter shading. So even though they would look like same color here, same color here, what happens is one color completely changes to like be the top dark color, the bottom side becomes light, and then they now live and swim. They kind of undulate, right?
Yeah, they don't quite do it completely flat. They will go to the side
a little bit.
You will see a little bit of that remnant of their original physiology, but you will also see that leftover fin. It's still there. It's just not nearly as active or as capable
or as developed
their,
even
or
really,
even
right?
as developed as their other fin. And they get that white underbelly. Their top oftentimes can also camouflage with the substrate, so they can change colors.
So yeah, change colors to match that bottom. Mm-hmm. We have a video. We have two videos that we'll wrap the class up with. We'll come back after we're done with the two videos. But walk us through these flatfish videos if you can, Cassandra. Can we go to our first flatfish video, please? These are only like 30 seconds long.
All right, so this is actually, this must be the fry, and this is the flatfish as their eye is migrating. So you can see that mouth and jaw start to develop, and see how that eye is starting to move. It's just starting to move. It looks like it's going to go a little bit further over. You can see it kind of shaping their face a little bit differently now. You can see how that face shape changes. And this is done when the flatfish is very, very tiny, usually microscopic. So you can see that going all the way through that skull there.
And then we have a second video. If we can watch the second video, this will show us a little bit more. Wait for it here. Okay. So there's another, it's fry to fish, all sound, yeah. All right, we'll get there in just a second. While we're waiting for the video to come up, can we go back to picture number 11? Picture number 11, please. There we go.
There you are.
So this is the flatfish once it's already done. Now we can look at this. So here's one eye and here's other. So it looks like this would have been a left fish, right? So this eye started out over here. So it was like over here, basically, right? So
migrated up.
So there was one eye here, and then there was one eye on the bottom, right? And then as it started to develop, this one literally migrated up here. So now it's here. The mouth changed a little bit.
Yeah, usually their mouth is kind of skewed a little bit sideways.
This and almost would have been their dorsal fin.
Yeah.
Right? And this would have been like their underside.
Yeah.
But now he's all flattened up. So, all right, so that new video is ready. Can we go to that last video, please?
Ah, so here we can see kind of that fry developing a little bit more. You can see the eye a little bit more clearly. It looks more like an eye. I apologize, the other one was just that dark shape there. You can see how the body shape is starting to develop and round out. We should start to see that eye coming over the top. There it is. So his eye is shifting. You can see that mouth kind of skewing a little bit. And you'll notice that this fish is still pretty transparent. And so it's still a very, very small fish. It doesn't have the external scales. There we are.
There it is. Can we go to the computer real quick? I just pulled up an image so we can see. This is just a drawing here. There we go. So this would be the halibut. This is what it looks like. It's the flatfish, right? Here's the eyes and the mouth, and these are ones that people eat all the time. Mm-hmm.
They get very large up in Alaska. You can see that operculum covering the gills right there.
Right over here, yeah. So very cool. All right, so that just about wraps up the class today. Cassandra, thank you for joining us and getting your hands all bloody and gooey and fun. Well, actually, I had gloves on, all right. With the fish, hopefully you guys enjoyed the dissection and didn't gross you out too much. The fish are definitely bloodier than the... squid. So, all right, don't forget discussion board is due next week, quiz is due next week, participation points are due next week, and then next Friday your midterm is due. I did check, it's 30 questions, 1 point each, so it's worth 30 points. The final will be worth 40 points because it's encompassing everything. So if you have any questions, please email me. Otherwise, I will see you next week. Thanks again.
Thank you.
All right, bye guys.